And that was one of the things that we talked about, Kunima, on our, I think on our advisory committee after our Los Angeles conversation, because so one of the drivers, so typically we have had drivers and Uber representatives in the room. This time around, we have Stephanie who's joining us from Uber, and we were chatting outside, and we know the same people now. We found out we know a couple folks. But so one of the things that came up in LA was one of the drivers said, so she and a rider came on to her, and there was this thing where she could just request not to have contact with that person again, because the chances of getting in contact with another driver are 1,000%, right? But she did come in contact with that person again, and he did approach her again. And so when we were talking about being on the island, we were talking about not only may you see the same driver again, they might be related to you, whoever you know.
Yeah, or you bump into them shopping or something like that, not even just with Uber. Like, you're gonna see them.
Well, another thing I'm thinking related to privacy is also they have access to your phone number, what you look like, your name, which maybe they could find you on social media, find other information about you through Google.
And just adding on to the privacy piece, talking about that access to the communities of that maybe may not have been visible. Not only does that driver now know where those communities are, they also have the knowledge to share with other people. And so, like, what kind of pieces are, like, like systems or privacy are available and intact to kind of protect that information from being shared with other people?
That's right.
And what about the rideshare piece in particular, or the Uber pool piece? What makes you more vulnerable?
The pool?
Mm-hmm. You don't know who you're getting.
You don't know who you're getting.
Bad enough you don't know the driver, but now you're adding other people to the mix.
And you could be matched multiple times.
Is there like a code of ethics for the for the drivers and for those who opt in to use the service?
I'm just going to say something to this point of who you're getting in the car with. I don't know if it's still this way, but back in the days, before the earth cooled, when I was an intern one summer living in Brooklyn, right, if you were going to take what they call the gypsy cabs.
Gypsy cabs, right?
So beyond a certain hour, like a group of women would congregate, right, and wait to all take the same car, drawn to situations.
Can you just prop that up for me?
Yes,
thank you.
That's a situation that people might gravitate to for those reasons.
That's exactly what I was thinking about. Like, if I was a predator, and a situation to exploit would be at the club, after the club, knowing you could car share or carpool, so then that would be my opportunity to get with someone who may be intoxicated. And I mean, because there's no bound, like, you could access, it's easy to see where the car is and who you're going to share with, when you can pick them up, and that would be an opportune time.
And I stay clear of them all together. When I go, when I travel for work by myself, I'll just rent a car, because I don't want to take any chances on, because you have so many tragic stories with the driver. Plus, Bone Collector was one of my favorite movies with Denzel Washington. So I think about all the bad stuff. But that's kind of what I tend to do, especially by myself. But if I'm traveling with someone or a group of people, I feel more comfortable doing it. So I can only imagine just getting in the car and then, like, three other people get in the car with me. I'm like, what's going on here? I would have anxiety, me myself.
Yeah.
I think there's a piece of, you know, for me, for personal space that comes into play, that just from a logistical, like, if you're in a rideshare and other people, additional people start to get in the car with you, for me, that creates a personal space issue. Like, not really having, like, complete control of your boundaries, like your physical space, and also the social piece of role of being a woman in that space then sometimes doesn't lend to feeling empowered to say, I don't want to sit in this particular spot. Mm. So I think that that can kind of come to play. The other piece that came to me as you were speaking was when you're getting in a car with multiple people, there's a bit of a pack mentality too that can kind of come up. And so if you're with multiple people that, you know, I remember getting in a ride share one time and they were, felt like the after party. as I was getting in, so I had two other people and I was like, okay. And they were, I was coming into conversations that they had been having and it was like, it was an odd conversation, but I remember just being like, oh, I'm not trying to participate in the conversation. But it was a very kind of camaraderie, kind of packed mentality of something that I was coming into, and I felt like a bit of an outsider, and I could just see if there was something happening, like someone was being inappropriate or making sexual advances, that it would have been very difficult for me to feel like I could say something because there was already this kind of communal packed thing that was happening in the space with the driver and the other passengers. It was a kind of an odd dynamic, and it's actually, I have not taken a like pool since that, like because of that. So, and it was nothing that was like a big, huge, you know, what would be like a big, huge red flag, but it was the multiple pieces of feeling uncomfortable and not feeling like I was empowered to say what I wanted to say or kind of create boundaries and ways. I was like, maybe this is not the thing for me, you know, like humility.
And what about, so we've had this long, so many conversations today about economics, and so what is the sort of economic piece in here that might increase your vulnerability?
Well, I know that, like, there's a consequence for canceling the ride. So, like, if she would have opened the door, saw the pack, and actually been like, I don't want to go, there's a financial consequence to that. And the pools are normally cheaper.
Yeah.
Right.
That's right.
But imagine that, you know, folks who, just from a cost-saving standpoint, if we're talking about marginalized and vulnerable people, like they're more likely to engage in the pool aspect and option versus doing a solo ride, just from an economic standpoint.
Yeah. Anything else?
Is there a different rate for children on Uber?
It
doesn't matter.
No,
it's the same.
Yeah,
it's the same.
For body.
Yeah.
So kids are very.
I wonder if, like, yeah, a single mother with children.
Yes. Yeah, so, like to your point, if you're a single mom, or you have your children with you, and you got a pool, you can only have two seats in a pool, up to two. So, in an X, you can have up to four. So it varies depending on the product that you choose.
Okay.
So yes, children are.
But can kids go by themselves?
Not under 18.
Although, last week, there is a part of New Orleans where the children are very young. And the mother wanted to put the child in by itself. The child was 14. And the driver was like, I don't feel comfortable with this, and this and that and the other thing. So,
well, good for them, because I was thinking, though, like if they're a child predator, because I know when I was 14, I looked like I was 19 or 20.
Yeah.
Like I was very developed.
Yes.
So you wouldn't know I was 14. So do they card or?
No.
Yeah.
It's up to their discretion.
Yeah. So if it's,
Yeah.
That's interesting. Because that just made me think, though, the many women that I know that, like, in doing this work, they can't necessarily pick their kids up from school, and not like 7-year-olds, but like middle school, high school.
That's
like,
right.
Like, calling a lift to your school, getting it to you at home, and they never have any problems with them. Right, right. And now there's like one of the things they were talking about is the kids have their own credit cards, and so they have their own Uber accounts.
Yeah,
and so they're just like, oh, I'll just call an Uber.
Yeah.
Or I'll just call a Lyft.
It's a pretty. I know several parents who, their children take Lyft or Uber, rideshare in general.
It's a generic term.
But they do it pretty consistently, and as a you know, with working with, because of working families, and, you know, that is essentially helpful to them in that way. And so that can definitely have its positive aspects. And these are families who do, like, who are, I think, very proactive in talking to the children about, like, you know, safety and how to do things. But I don't even know what that, you know, those conversations would look like in order to kind of prepare and be ready. And or, you know, in general, that can be a safety risk for kids.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Can you put it on my jump drive, please?
Anything else? We've got quite a collective of folks.
I don't use Uber and Lyft too often. I've used Uber the whole time I've been here. But what about for people with mobilities? Like, mobility issues? Like, I'm able-bodied, but each car that I've gotten into, I don't see how, for some individuals, that would have been accessible for me. So that would, I wonder if I had any physical disability, then that would force me to be more dependent on the driver. So I wonder if that could
help to get into the car. And
then there's touching and, I
just wonder. Collapsing wheelchairs.
And it's like more of a dependent. Can they physically help people get into the car?
Yes, so before you're onboarded, you receive training, ADA training on how to, you know, properly collapse, how to, you know, help the passenger. In Florida, in other states, there are what's a product called wheelchair accessible vehicles, WAVE, and so they, of course, obviously are trained and have the proper vehicles for your motorized vehicles, but in Florida, currently, it's just the foldable chairs that they receive training on. But a good point on the making you dependent.
Is there some type of notification if someone is either deaf or blind?
Yes, so there is on the driver, obviously the driver's not blind, but we do have deaf and hard of hearing drivers. And so I don't know if you've ever matched with one, it's pretty interesting. It'll pop up that you've just matched with a driver that's, so that if especially for them, so that there's no awkwardness as to why they're not acknowledging you or having conversation. I do not believe it happens
in the reverse.
That's a good question.
And I want to add also LEP, limited English proficiency. Because coming here, this was the first time that I had a driver that didn't speak English. And I thought, wow, what? How vulnerable is that making him? That, so on the flip side too, even for the rider, you know, what kind of vulnerability there is around that. So one of the things that we wanted to do in our conversation is we wanted to add primary prevention, the conversation about primary prevention into this conversation, because women of color don't often get a chance to talk about primary prevention unless we're like working in a program and we're like the prevention coordinator or something like that. So we really wanted to introduce, how many folks are familiar with primary prevention in the room? Amazing, I might call on y'all. So we wanted to introduce this in too, also because I was a Delta coordinator, so anytime I can talk about the social ecological model, I'm happy. But what we're really working at WOCN and how we've chosen to address the project is to really say from the outset that we are attempting to change the knowledge, attitudes, beliefs, and behaviors of folks. So for riders, for drivers, but also for Uber as a corporation, right? So one thing about knowledge is we know that for a change in knowledge, we have to provide succinct and clear information, and that can happen one time. We call those aha moments where you just hear something and it clicks for you, and then your consciousness is expanded. And then we have the attitude. So for a change in attitude, you have to provide information and an appeal to people's emotions and or personal impact. So when we think about what we were talking about this morning about survivor stories and bringing folks in, a lot of times we do that because we're trying to change the attitude of whoever the audience is. And we know that attitudes take time and multiple encounters to change. And then the hardest thing to change is beliefs and behaviors, right? These, in order to change beliefs and behaviors, you have to demonstrate and practice new skills and communicate with other people during the learning process. And this usually takes multiple times
to change, to practice these new skills and change beliefs and behaviors. So for beliefs and behaviors, I would say, like, we know that, you know, if you want to quote unquote lose weight or do those things, they say eat right and exercise, right? We know that, right? But yeah, I just ate my cookie and I might have another one and I probably am not going to exercise, right? So we know that it takes more than just a one-time thing to change behaviors. We have to really address people's beliefs and their behaviors if we really want to create social change. And so we really want to work on the prevention continuum, right? So anything that is happens before the violence occurs, then we would say that was primary prevention, right? And so what we're really focusing on is the conditions that support intimate partner violence or sexual violence. We want to focus on promoting the protective factors and decreasing the perpetration,
right?
And then anything that happens after the violence occurs, we say is intervention. And I heard kernels of it even today, that you need a mix of prevention and intervention if you're really going to create social change. You can't do just a one-time thing, right? So a complex vision would be, because we know that adolescents are influenced by many factors or people, right, not just adolescents, that support or condone intimate partner domestic violence, each of the factors needs to be addressed in a consistent, systematic manner. So that means we have to work at all levels of what we call the social ecological model, which I will talk about in a second. So the complex vision assumes knowledge, changes in the environment, and long-term programs are needed. So we are working from sort of a complex vision, right? We're having conversations with folks, listening to you all, and then we will present that new knowledge to Uber, to the riders, to the drivers. But our goal is to work at every level of what we call the social ecological model. Kunama, I think you raised your hand. Mm-hmm. You want to talk a little bit about the social ecological model?
Sure, because I have to talk about it in my grants all the time. So it's looking basically at the different levels of influence, and so it's a perfect gradual, I guess you can look at the growth of it from the chart, but you look at issues from an individual level. So if you look at like domestic violence and sexual violence, you look at your personal experience and how that might have an effect on the way that you see and view things. But then you also have your relationship with others. So the people who are, say, like your family and your friends, people who are within your network, and the influence that they will have on the decisions that you will make. So I guess if we put it in terms of Uber, so let's do it in terms of Uber.
Yeah.
So individual for me, like from an island that we don't have Uber yet, my experience with it is based on the fact that I really don't know much. So that's why I'm asking a lot of questions. Then relationship, I do have friends and family who are stateside and who have used it. Matter of fact, the first Uber I had was my best friend. She was like, I'll just get you an Uber. And I was like, what? What do you mean? And then when a random person picked me up, I was like, where is like the cab number? Where's all this stuff? But I trusted it because even though as an individual I had never experienced it, my family, you know, she's like my family to me. I said, well, she's my BFF, so she wouldn't put me in a compromising position, so I'm going to trust that I can use the Uber. So even though on an individual basis I had one perspective of it, it was kind of crazy to me. From a relationship, you know, point of view, I just trusted that this is what I could do.
Yeah.
Then there's a community perspective. So now that I get to be, you know, in this space, so this is kind of like my closer community. It's not society, people impact how I think and what I do. But you're not quite family, but you're like extended family, so you're my community. Now we're talking about this because I realized that this is not just something that friends and family do. This is something that it's affecting our community. It's going into the intersections, right, of sexual violence, domestic violence.
Yes.
So it goes beyond just the people who are close to me.
Yeah.
And then there's the societal part of it where, you know, I may never interact with everybody who uses Uber, but we realize that it has an impact. So, and you know, it kind of goes from individual out to society, but then society affects the individual, community and relationship also affects the individual.
Which,
so usually when we write grants, we try to look at it from that whole perspective, understanding survivors, trauma, the way that we, you know, I say we because I'm a survivor too, the way that we see things, there are multiple levels of influence.
Yeah.
And so these are the various levels.
Which is, and thank you, that was
awesome.
Beautiful. Yes, so amazing. And so that's why all of the circles are connected, right? Because they all flow back and forth with each other. Mm-hmm. So the way to think about the social ecological model is that, so these are vehicles, right? So this is how we think of it in our work. Mm-hmm. These are vehicles for getting our messages across, right? Mm-hmm. So what that means is, so in our work, what we would do is, on the individual level, this might be sort of the trainings that we have with either the riders or the drivers, or maybe when I come to Chicago and do that training that we talked about, right? With the drivers, right? to change their knowledge, attitude, beliefs, and behaviors on an individual level, right? And then what we want to do is we want to change the relationship that those drivers have, not just with their friends, family, etc., but with their sort of the folks that we want to change their mindset, right? So that they will have a different relationship to the people that may be getting in their cars, right? And then on the community level, we want to change how those drivers see the community that they're in. And so in order to do that, we also need to shift the community of Uber, because we're all just people, right? So we want to change the community, the environment of Uber, which is why we're doing this work, right? And then societal, what big macro levels can we change? Like we were talking about possible legislation that may need to happen, right? So how can we affect the larger society? So these are avenues. The social ecological model, they're avenues that can be thought of to change individual level. Development, change, and maintenance can be promoted. So any prevention work that we're doing, any strategizing that we're doing, has to work at each level of the model, right? And then this is just a quote. It is unreasonable to expect that people will change their behavior easily when so many forces in the social, cultural, and physical environment conspire against such change. Mm-hmm. We've been talking about this all day, mm-hmm. right? And we even know this in our personal lives. There's so, you know, when people say, oh, why doesn't she just leave, right? Mm-hmm. It's like, oh, we have all these resources for you. You know, it's 2018. You know where the domestic violence shelters are. But all the things we talked about this morning, low wages, low support, all of those things impact that person's belief system and their ability to change.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And each one is a microcosm of the other.
That's
like
right.
We're a microcosm of our
society. Yeah. You want to? You said each one is.
Yeah. So a lot of times when people make like general statements like that, it's like, well, what? How are we responding? So we have to look at the individual basis too. So it's like, even if you never experienced domestic violence or sexual violence. So some people feel like they could be removed from it because it's like, oh, well, I'm not a part of that world, but we are a microcosm.
That's right.
We're like a reflection. So what if we're not involved? It's like if you're not part of the solution, you're part of the problem,
that
kind of thing. Because we contribute to it even on a much larger level. Like it starts with individuals that make up the whole society. So we have to look at ourselves and be reflective.
And that's one of the things that when A Call to Men does their work, they talk about, so we know that only this amount of men commit violence, right?
Mm-hmm.
So we're not necessarily focused on this amount of men. We're focused on the amount of men that don't commit violence.
Right. Right.
And how are these large numbers of men letting these folks be violent? So
right.
It's sort of that same
Correct.
Thing.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Questions, comments?
I was going to say, in the relationship, it's also like the relationship between the Uber drivers and Uber.
Yes.
Like not just the community of Uber, but the authority in Uber.
That's
and
right.
And like how they perceive the authority and how they take the guidance from the authority, whether or not they buy into it, like what's the incentive for them.
That's right.
You know, what's the protections for them.
That's right.
It's, you know, the whole cycle of that relationship, I think, is important.
That's right. And so that's why we felt like, as an organization, we need to work at all those levels with the organization. So on the individual level, it could be curriculums, counseling, mentoring for riders and drivers. On the relationship level, support programs, mentoring maybe from Uber to drivers. From the community level, social norms, so changing the social norms of the organization through the conversations and recommendations that we have here, we would be presenting those recommendations to them and saying, hey, y'all need some new social norms, right? And then again, the societal media campaign policy changes that they could possibly do. So that's what the work would look like if it was a comprehensive strategy.
I have a question about what sort of look back at taxi services or even the gypsy taxis or, you know, what have you, what sort of look back to those long-standing institutions that have created, especially taxis, right? They've created almost complete sense of trust with people. Mm-hmm. And it's more so the drivers that get aggressed against as opposed to the riders in taxis. At least that's what I see, right? Like I see stories of taxi drivers being aggressed against by passengers. And so I'm curious as to, without taking it out of the rideshare category, mm-hmm. without institutionalizing it to the point of becoming a taxi, like right. this is the whole point, right?
Yeah. Right.
What do we know what things they have in place that have worked that protect against these things? What sort of oversight that doesn't transgress into the bounds of removing that, you know, like community aspect of the whole rideshare situation?
So taxis. I think it's interesting that folks think that they're safer.
Yeah.
Right. because in New York City, you know, just up until 2 years ago, there were task forces that were set up because taxi drivers were doing exactly the things that we were talking about. They were going picking up drunk girls and raping them. So things happen in taxis too. We know that taxis do not pick up certain people.
Right.
So I think that I don't think they have the market on
I'm
safety
in,
piece. Like,
yeah,
they
I'm not in an area where we use taxis
yeah.
for
yeah.
transportation.
Yeah.
It's airport home,
yeah.
home airport.
Yeah.
Right.
Right.
Yeah, we don't hail cabs.
So right.
Yes.
Exactly. And even for me, like I live in New York City, but I've lived in all the places I've lived, I've needed a car. So
yes.
I still have my car. But so yeah, if you're not driving in like a taxi place,
yeah.
These aren't things that you typically hear
right.
about.
Right.
So one of the drivers that was in the space in Los Angeles, she talked about with Uber, there are certain guidelines that you have to have for cars, but with taxis, not necessarily. Like you can take the doorknobs, you can take the
right.
locks off the back seat. They can trick out those taxis to make it less safe. So I think having those things like the mirrors up, at least the taxis in New York City, make me feel safer.
And the walls.
Yeah.
Yes. I was like, Lord, I'm in a police car right
yeah.
now.
Yeah. But I think they're struggling with the same thing. I think one of the things with Uber is because it's new and because of social media,
right.
everything is out there. And so I think that taxis are probably having the same sort of
yeah.
I get the question though, because like with me and my first experience, I just felt like a taxi would be safer. Now because I'm in the work, I definitely know that it's the same.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But I just felt, but I guess because it's more uniformed or
right.
scarce.
Yeah. There's
right. more
those numbers. Like those.
Yes, you know, like I call these people
like,
and report you, and like I have your number, but like it's like Uber is a different car every time, and a different
yeah.
person. And so is a taxi, really.
Yeah,
but it just appears to
yeah.
be.
Yeah.
yeah,
yeah. And I guess it's just because it's been around.
Yeah,
like,
I would
like,
say too.
It's like I don't want to say religion, but it's I don't want to
no.
say religion. Oh my God, I'm Catholic today. Did y'all see the Pope? What the Pope said?
No.
No.
Did y'all,
you said you're Catholic today.
Yeah, I'm Catholic today. So I was raised Catholic, but I said Catholic today because the Pope just said to a gay person, God made you this way and you're a child of God. So I'm Catholic today. Yes, but I'm just using it as an example. It's like Catholic versus like Scientology. Like some people would just trust it because it's been around longer.
Yes,
it doesn't mean
yeah.
that they don't have lots of stuff going on.
Yeah.
But they've just been established longer. Whereas yeah, something that's new where people tend to question it more.
Right.
Yeah.
I think one of the things too that folks have made it makes feel a little bit safer, at least for me, because I think you're right, it's counterintuitive to get into a stranger's car, right?
Yeah.
You were raised your whole life.
Right.
Do not
don't
get
talk
into
to strangers.
Don't talk to them.
One of the things that's, at least for me and my experience, is the fact that you can track your trip, and I don't know that many people know this feature.
Right.
I can actually share my trip, so I can see, like, my mom, my sister, or if I'm in a situation where I'll send it to them, they can actually see where I'm going, and because I have all his information, whereas sometimes I've left a taxi and I didn't get that, I forgot to take a picture of the number,
so
it's like, I feel like I have access to get back to that person or figure out, you know, what that situation was because of the technology of the app.
Yeah.
So once you kind of get past the feeling of I just got a stranger's car, it's like, oh, okay, well, at least I can see my route and then she's following my route.
Taxis, they're not good at all the time keeping track of who your driver was.
Yeah. Oh, is that right?
They're not good. We use it for shelter, for after hours. If someone, if a survivor needs to go to the hospital, and we had to, it took us a while because there were two different men that was coming to the shelter primarily to pick up the ladies, and one of them was dating like three different girls at the shelter, and it was this big situation. It was for the longest that we had to figure out which of the two of them, and it was like on a particular day this one came, and you know, it was like not me, you know. Well, the schedule said it was this person, but he said it's not him. And it was like, well, we don't know who it is, but we don't want him coming back.
No, for sure.
You know.
Oh, my goodness.
Mm-hmm. Are there any sort of, like, mechanisms, like, when you get into an Uber, you know, especially as a female? Because, like, when Uber first came out, so I'll just bring a faith dynamic into this.
Mm-hmm.
So religiously speaking, for Orthodox or observant women, we don't, we're not supposed to be alone with someone.
Mm-hmm.
And this is from a cisgendered framework. We're not supposed to be alone with someone who identifies as the opposite gender.
Mm-hmm.
And so this conflict arose because I was like, this is super helpful. I feel like I have a personal driver.
Yeah.
You know? And I used it sometimes just to feel like a baller. So I mean, like, oh, I let my car into the so I had a conflict about this religious rule applied to me. So I was like, I really wish there was a way to select a female one.
Yeah.
Right? But then I thought about mentally, you know, I worked through how that would be a problem.
Yeah.
But then I was like, well, what if I was to have someone automatically notified of me being in a car with someone, so that there was like this third party who was notified that I was picked up, and then they'd be notified when I got out.
Mm. We have it.
We just
rolled it out.
No.
Yeah, it's called share. It's called shared contacts, but we took it to another level where, like, every time you're in a car, it goes to, and you can designate the third parties up to five people.
That's wow, that's good.
So every trip, they get a note. They're like, oh, Stephanie, is going here. Every trip I'm on, they see drivers arriving. She's en route. Trip complete. She's here. And you can check it, and you can see where you were, where the trip started and ended.
And can you control that? Because,
you
know, because if they hit the button and says
it. It's all done in your eyes.
Okay.
Yeah.
But that also presents challenges, not to add another couple but like presents challenges of your perpetrator
access to
all of your, you know, because I imagine this is a profile.
Mm-hmm.
So if my partner who is abusive and wants to track all of my whereabouts.
If they have the login to your account,
which is
why we're here, because we're the experts to know.
So, I feel like the safety aspect, but then it's also like you just added another way for my partner to know my whereabouts.
Well, and I was also going to ask if it shares the driver's, like, a picture or anything, which on the one hand, that would be safe if something did happen, but then on the other hand, if you're the person, if you're a writer that's a perpetrator, you also share that to a bunch of people. I wonder if there's, like, on Samsung phones, you can turn on a feature where if you triple click your power button, it sends a picture of you, a
recording of what's going on and your location to emergency contacts in case of any emergency. Mm-hmm. I had to turn it off because it kept happening in my purse. Mama told me, I'd be like, what's going on? Because it's like SOS, emergency, and it immediately will send it. And I think it also does it like in intervals for the picture. Like there's one that happens and then 10 seconds later. So I wonder if there's some type of feature that can be put on there. Like, I had a friend that shared a story. I don't remember if it was Uber or Lyft, but she said she was in D.C. And the guy started taking all these different routes. And she was like, I know where I'm going. And he was like, no, 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 this way will be easier. And she was like, no, sir, you need to get back on the route. He would not listen. And then eventually she saw him, like, end the ride, but then keep driving. And she pretty much had to, like, tuck and roll out the car.
Oh, my God.
So that could have been a situation where that's just like, I'm in the back seat, and I can, like, click a button or double-click something that would send information to Uber and to this emergency contact with the name, you know, whatever.
We have good news.
Yeah, the 911 feature.
We just launched this feature that you're describing now, this rapid SOS or this SOS 911 option in the app. And a lot of what we're learning from these types of listening sessions have been turned into these product features. We're not 100% there yet, but this is what you just described came out of a session just like this.
And what does that trigger?
Depending on the state and depending on the 911 infrastructure within the state, there's an actual SOS button that connects you directly to 911, and then in some states where they have your more updated 911, it could actually pinpoint your location and it sends that directly to 911, right? So we're tapping into their ability, it's almost like, have you seen the debate with the whole being able to text to 911? It's those 911 centers that have upgraded their technologies that we can. I know specifically Denver, the city of Denver is working with us to pilot this specifically. The others right now are just connecting you with 911. You're still going to have to communicate with where you are. Now, on the flip side, once we're notified or that, you know, Uber knows that there's, we do share that information with law enforcement, should law enforcement. And we share that your location, you know, we know on the back end where we work with law enforcement every day on things like this. But it's, to your point, does that make sense? There's like a different, I know.
This might be too meaty. So does Uber have the infrastructure to do that? Like if I were to call 911, and mostly I actually literally had a similar experience, which is why I stopped using Uber. Because the person was going off the thing, and I wrote a response, and I it was the only time I ever wrote like an actual comment. You know, I guess my question would be is like, what does the back end look like that as far as like, what are y'all doing on the back end to support that? Because if people start knowing about it and then they use it, you know, like what does that look like with respect to capacity?
Yeah, see, I don't know all the technology. I know we're partnering with a company, it's called Rapid SOS.
Yes.
So it seems like we're partnering with someone that has the actual expertise.
And what I would say is the purpose of these discussions is to talk about what we want to see.
Yes.
And so when we get to the part about restorative justice, I would like for you to tell us what you would like to see, because we're making the road as we're walking.
Yes.
So some of those things have not been put into action yet. So don't forget.
Okay. I'll do my best. I should probably write it down.
Try to write it down. Because we want to know what you want to see. So then we can say, have you thought about this?
Yes.
Have you thought about this? Have you thought about that?
Yes. Well, I'm just weary about it just triggering the police.
That's I know.
Oh, yes.
And the other thing I think about that is it makes me think of the video with the black driver and the white woman where she was screaming like, I'm going to say you raped. If she wouldn't trigger this 911 thing, police show up.
Yes. Yes.
And then also I wonder about a feature where, because like I can use my Uber to call Uber for someone else. So is there some type of mechanism that's like, take a picture of the person who got me? I don't know what that would look like.
So when you order an Uber for someone else, it's technically their attached to, they'll see their picture and their information. Is that what you're saying? Like they won't see you.
So I have ordered Uber as if I'm ordering it for myself, and I'm like with a friend. Uber comes and then I'm like, okay, bye, they get in the car.
Got it.
And the reason why I think about this is not that James Winston is a decent human being, but
he just got caught up in something.
Yes.
With yeah. The person, the driver, woman, yes. the driver, and he said, I wasn't even in the car.
Yes.
I called it for my
yes.
friend.
Yes. I know.
What was that?
James Winston, the football.
Yeah,
I remember. Yeah.
I would say, so that's one of the reasons we updated it. So now, like literally live, I can show you. And we need to do, there's so, been so many updates, it's hard to educate on. Mm-hmm. But the literally with the quick click of a drop down, anyone in your contacts, as long as their phone number's there, it will be attached to them. Mm-hmm. And that's honestly the safest, best way.
Yeah.
Because even if there was an accident in the car insurance-wise, right now that would, and there was happened to be an accident separate of all of that we're discussing, there would be issues because the, yeah, of who's in the car.
So,
so
you
I know that doesn't answer your, but like in the future, make sure it's
I'm literally
Do you see it?
Yeah.
Where you can, it's hidden though. It's not super clear that you can do it. See how it says four and your name.
It was actually a little banner at the bottom
yes.
of when I opened my Uber app.
Yeah.
It was a banner that asked that I want to add trusted contacts.
Yes.
And then
that's
it brought me to my for access to my contacts
yes.
and then brought my contacts.
Yes. And y'all might want to reach out to Rapid SOS also because they reached out to us a couple years ago. They're looking for nonprofits to partner with and to provide services to. So what they, so for example, when they called me, because so folks who are in apartment buildings, this is getting a little off topic and I'm gonna get back to your question. But one of the things she said to me, so for example, the when the Pulse nightclub shooting happened, the police did not know specifically where the people were, because 911 can go to a location, but if you're in an apartment
yes.
building, those
yes,
type of things don't show up on 911, which I had no idea before
mm-hmm.
talking to this woman. And so what that Rapid SOS also does is it helps them to know where you actually
yes.
are. So me being the advocate, I'm like, okay, wait a minute, what if they got GPS on your phone? Like, what, you know, what if the perpetrator has access to your
mm-hmm.
profile? But I would still check out the service. One, because at least when they reached out to us 2 years ago, they were giving the software to nonprofits free for like 2 years. So it's good to study. It's new technology, but again, the more of us that are involved in these conversations, the better, because like we were talking about, these companies sprout up, they grow so quickly, they don't talk to us, and then all these things happen.
Yeah,
last one, and then we're going to the second question.
Just to go back about the safety with the survivors, when they come into the shelter, the first thing we do, I didn't get to touch on the digital world card, but is create a safe email for them, and also the anti-spyware. So encourage them to put the anti-spyware on any tablets, laptops, cell phones that they have, especially iPhone. I don't know why iPhone users, they mostly keep on their Bluetooth. And it'll allow people to, because my daughter was sending me pictures from my old phone, and it was nothing that prompted me to say yes, she could do that. And I seen all these pictures coming through, and I'm like,
what
is all this stuff? And she was sending it through the Bluetooth, you know, of the phones. But to maybe encourage that, so that way the abuser doesn't have access to their profile. So, you know, to talk about that when they, when you first have contact with the survivor, because mirroring the phones is very popular now.
That's right, exactly.
So,
along those lines, and also what you were talking about, y'all are like the perfect folks. So, what baseline information does Uber need to know about rape culture and consent? Baseline, because when we first started these conversations, we had all these things that we wanted Uber to do, and then somebody on our advisory committee said, wait a minute, we need baseline. Baseline, what do they need to know about rape culture? Right? Was that you, or was it? I think that was on the call. It was me, you, and from IOOV. So what baseline information do they need to know about rape culture and consent?
That it looks exactly the same in every single community, with some, maybe some variances as to like the explanations for the abuse or the, you know, justifications or whatever. But right, that they shouldn't differentiate when somebody is targeting a, you know, targeting women, they will employ the same exact tactics whether they're coming from a faith-based environment or, you know, or not. And we have seen that in terms of predatory behavior of clergy or people in positions of power. So yeah, I have more to say on that, but they will use the same tactics. So don't get into the minutia of cultural differences to a certain point.
Yeah, right.
It will look the same.
Thank you.
Yeah.
What else?
Mm-hmm. I think also a conversation about all the ways that it shows up, like the spectrum of what it looks like. Because I know I've just been in a car with a dude that wouldn't fucking shut up and just kept talking and telling me how nice I looked and was trying to tell me all these home. I was sick. He was trying to tell me like how to take care of myself and all this other stuff, and I was like, I'm good, I got this, and he just kept talking. And then he also tried to tell me I didn't know where I was going and all this stuff. And then when he dropped me off, he was like, so 5 stars, right? And
no,
I was like, no,
Lord.
Absolutely not. Well, why not? And that goes back to how it could be dangerous. I was living on the edge and I was like, fuck no.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
Because you don't feel like you can really let that other person inside you come out.
Yeah.
Because they got your address and all those
right.
other things.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
Well, basically, I guess tailoring off of that, like boundaries, like
yeah.
being able to have some appropriate, like baseline boundaries with people, or like, you know, like respecting the fact that you were trying to cut that conversation off, you know? Yeah.
What else?
You're thinking baseline that it's pervasive, so, and it's supported, when you think about the socio-ecological model, it's supported by everything, you know? So I may be teaching, I have a 15-year-old son, doing my best to teach him, you know, to not adopt toxic masculinity when he goes to school,
right.
and that's teachers
yes.
that are supporting, that the school climate supports that. So I have to, he has to come home, and we have to process those things.
Right.
You know?
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. I mean, yes, the obvious
yeah.
one, but just recognizing that, you know, what we think as traditional safe spaces are not necessarily safe spaces. So,
thank you.
No can be unspoken.
Mm.
So a lot of times we say no means no. So if they said no, that means no. But sometimes you don't get to speak no because you're in such shock of what's going on.
Mm-hmm. Or you use other words.
Or you use other words, right. Or nonverbal,
right.
you know, cues. Mm-hmm. So being aware of that. That just because someone doesn't say no doesn't mean it's yes either.
I think that's, you know, I think about Aziz Ansari, and there was so much dialogue around that, and they were like, well, clearly he wasn't abusive, or he was,
mm-hmm.
but it was like, no, she was saying no
right.
in so many different ways,
right?
right?
Yeah.
And that was hard for people
to understand. Yeah.
And men that appear to be heterosexual, and they may be, they'll say, but they still can be prejudiced towards, you know, gay men. They have assaulted, they may use objects rather than, you know, their personal tool, but not to just think that they may be safe in a ride share just because, you know, this man appears to be heterosexual, you know, there could be, you know, a situation still.
Absolutely. Thank you.
And at the end of the day, it's about power and control.
Yes.
Right.
So they have to understand as drivers that the minute somebody gets in their car, they're
mm-hmm.
in a position of power.
I think that extends to drivers too, though.
Yes,
right.
Oh,
yeah, that's
what
I was
going to
say.
Song,
yeah.
Yeah.
For the drivers,
mm-hmm.
that's what I'm saying.
Especially for the female.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, drivers. I was about to ask, are drivers allowed to carry, like, whether it's tasers or mace or?
Yeah. So in Florida, we have to follow what the law is in Florida. So even if you're concealed, you have your concealed carry.
Yeah.
You know, all the way to your tasers and your mace. Some even have put in the video. You'll notice them too when they're in the dashboard, just as a measure.
I didn't even think about that till you said that.
Yeah.
So personal.
Yeah,
uh-huh.
like personal with respect to gun laws.
Yeah.
Being in someone's car. Like I had not, out of all the things, I had never even thought about. Yeah, I am in Texas, so
yeah.
I've never even thought about. I was like, I never thought about the reciprocity.
Gun
yeah, with
guns.
Yeah.
Yeah. And so, what is Uber's corporate responsibility
around rape culture and consent?
Or education.
Frontline defense.
What does that mean?
That means that they have to adopt understanding the platform that they have provided makes them automatic frontline responders when people get, they have a responsibility to protect people, and they have a responsibility to change their culture if necessary. And the education person, they have a responsibility. So it's not just about they're doing it for good PR. They actually have what should be a legal responsibility. The same way that certain institutions have a legal responsibility, or people have a legal responsibility to report, to be mandatory reporters, for example. I don't think you can extend it that far. You might be able to, but their responsibility goes just up to that point.
What else?
Is there a notification in place, like with ride share, if I feel uncomfortable or can't say the verbal no, that I'm able to send something to the driver via my app?
So would you want to do it? You're not saying you would want to do it during the trip, maybe after?
Like even during the trip.
Yeah,
like most of the time in ride share, I'm on my phone, so I could send something to the driver.
Yes.
Is the driver then obligated to respond, like she said, like is the driver obligated or responsible to, I guess you can't make that responsibility of another citizen, but if we're using that same platform, so then if the driver gets that, what are we training? I say we, like I'm a part of Uber. What are we training the driver to do? What options are we providing, or what options does the driver have to respond to that cue from a rider who's now in danger? And you know,
so again, I'm going to ask you what you would like to see.
Oh,
because again, we are making the road by walking.
Okay,
and we don't get to have. So this is the other piece why I'm glad y'all are also here. How often do women of color get to have these conversations where you get to say, "This is actually what I would like to see." Because clearly they need our assistance. No shade. So don't forget that, please. Okay.
They have a responsibility to have a clear, precise position and policy.
Right.
And not just a policy, but how that's actually implemented out, like on the different levels, with respect to, you know, at all levels, like which departments internally you're going to be involved with that, how kind of workplace policies support that, what their accountability for drivers is on that.
Got it.
So that multifaceted, like actual institutionalized response. And I think this is where we're getting at with this here. But I think that that's like the number one social corporate responsibility piece.
So I'm going to come back to you about what you would like to see since we're talking. So what would you like to see happen? So you've sent something to the driver.
Right.
What would you like to have happen?
Can I, related to this, it seems to me that part of your question is whether or what Uber is doing with its drivers about bystander intervention.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And what that looks like.
Mm-hmm.
It's not happening yet. Well,
yeah. That's why we're
that's
here.
Why we,
right.
Well,
that's
so
why we're
here. I read somewhere, right, about people being uncomfortable in a bar and being able to go to the bartender and ask for something with a code word. I want an angel shot or whatever. And the bartender understands that code and knows there needs to be an intervention or you need a cab or something.
Okay.
So some kind of, you know, the driver can say something to the person like, you know, do I need to let you off here? Or some kind of way in which there can be a coded interaction.
So I would say then we're asking people to text and drive.
Well.
Let me see if I understand. You were saying in terms of the ride share, if there's a passenger that is assaulting or in some way infringing on the space, the personal space of another driver, of another passenger,
right.
and they're able to alert the driver what we want the driver to do. So in that case, the driver isn't actually texting, it would be the passenger, right?
But they have to read it.
Oh, but they have, yeah.
I wonder if there's something that could be like,
could
the screen
color
light up a certain
yeah.
color.
That's what I'm saying. It could just be a color
or
code.
Ding,
like,
or maybe
like
that there's
a red flash.
Oh, like
or
like
a
word
at
another
or
stop
mm-hmm.
for the driver
okay.
that's
yeah.
a safe
yeah.
place.
Yeah.
Like
mm-hmm.
we're going straight to the police
yeah.
station.
Right.
We're going straight to
the
police
station.
Yeah.
A flash. Like a red flash. You're
technically looking at a GPS monitor, right?
Yes.
Yeah.
But it would also have to be something like people, like the other passengers wouldn't necessarily see.
Right.
So like
mm-hmm.
if the screen just went bright red and was like, your passenger's
yeah.
in danger.
Right.
Yeah, then they'll
right.
know.
Right.
Right.
Or since they're on the GPS, maybe, you know, because it's typically taking them, you know, it's a some type of circle or whatever. So maybe if the circle went, you know, started to not make a, you know, an obvious change
yes.
in
right.
color, but, you know, maybe went red and then went blue and then went red and then went blue or something. And then
okay,
you'll
yeah.
know. Yeah.
Ding.
Yeah.
Well, sometimes they have it through their headphones.
Right.
There could also be, this might make a lot of sense if they had it. You know how most people's GPS is on the right?
Mm-hmm.
If they have something on the left where not everybody can see,
mm-hmm.
and they go through a process of training around abuse and violence, and they become like listed as a safe driver, like
mm-hmm.
yep. what's the SBCAR?
Yeah.
What is it? Sanctuary?
Yes.
Is there a sanctuary car?
Yes.
And so they've
mm-hmm.
gone through a certain level of training and been accredited as
yeah.
a sanctuary driver.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And then that one on the left-hand side, if something's happening in a pool, then it can say, you know, passenger blah, blah, blah needs help,
yeah.
you know, or something like that. And
yeah.
nobody else can really see that if it's in a certain spot.
Yeah.
So I don't know if
that came up last week as well, having like a special sort of pool
right.
of drivers.
Right.
So, that can be identified
yeah.
as
yeah.
that
and being certified
to be, yeah.
Yeah,
yeah,
they've gone through some kind of a voluntary process.
Yeah.
And so it would open them up. But maybe they expend the money to become that certified person so that the onus is not necessarily just on Uber.
Yeah.
But it becomes like it's a selling feature for them because somebody could select,
oh, yeah.
I want a sanctuary driver.
Yeah.
Or
maybe it's a lot of VOCA dollars. Maybe VOCA could pay. You know, maybe Uber can partner with VOCA to see if, you know, they could pay for that.
We've talked about it a little bit at a higher level.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So I'm having a halfway thought, which means like I haven't finished it.
Okay.
But you know how there's waves where people can alert, like there's a police car on the way or there's
oh,
a
yeah.
waves.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. So I don't know, maybe there's something similar that could be done. Now this is a halfway thought.
Mm-hmm.
But where if somebody selects like there's right. something happening that other Uber drivers in the area
mm-hmm.
could see that this car,
ooh.
There's someone in this car that's in distress,
mm-hmm.
or so that's where the halfway thought ends because I haven't figured out what happened. But you know, so because if we're talking about bystander, it's not just on the responsibility isn't just on the driver,
mm-hmm.
somebody who's even in the car,
mm-hmm.
but other Uber
the
drivers.
Community.
Who, yeah, the
yeah.
community.
Yeah,
I don't know.
Thank you.
Really
do you great. Feel like you're complete with what you raised? Do you feel like you got enough, or do you need to
I feel like you guys have walked this thing out. Like the bystander, the ideas, and this will work, this will
there's
work,
some
the way.
App software.
I know.
Right.
Yeah.
That's awesome.
That's
yeah.
Hilarious.
Yeah.
Well,
this is so
great.
Well,
I would also say that, like,
yes.
you're like, I'm under no impression that there's not some high-level executive in Uber that's not sexually assaulting people
mm-hmm.
or harassing people,
yes.
like especially in the age of Me Too.
Yeah.
So maybe they could also set a good example by not just implementing something for the drivers,
mm-hmm.
but like culturally.
Of course.
Yes.
Corporate.
Yes.
To say like you said, the statement that's like, we don't stand,
mm-hmm.
whatever,
yeah.
and the, here's an anonymous place where if you're being
yeah.
harassed or whatever,
right.
like,
mm-hmm.
come forward.
Yeah.
And
I think that that's helpful, and I think that what, like, to me, the meat of that is what does that look like, right? And what does that look like in a responsible, accountable way? I think that there's also, you know, there's kind of different schools of thought with, like, if someone does X, Y, Z, then they should immediately fire to let go or whatever. And then there's schools of thought where it's also like accountability focus, and you know, what's the change that can happen? So what kind of options are available for people to really make that change, right? Because I think what happens, and this is from me coming from my, like, I never did kind of BIP or perpetrator work. I was always in victim services. And I know that in order for us to make change, have that social change, it takes time. And if someone, you know, just like we work with, you know, abusive partners, like just when abuser, you know, goes from one victim to another victim, from another victim, they're going to keep abusing until they have that intervention, right? And that behavioral change. I think one of the things from a corporate lens is that, you know, to consider all spectrums of options, not just termination, but also in ways rebuild it. Like, you know, we want to make sure that actual change is happening. So what does that look like? And what does that look like from an employment lens? And what kind of supports would that person need in order to create that change? You know, I think that's a struggle that we have a lot of times, not just, you know, even in our own work, is that we have a lot of victim services that are free. And many times we don't have perpetrator services that are free. And so in many ways, we're not getting up to that social change. And so from a corporate lens, corporations may have more resources available to them, can partner with amazing organizations like or get all these folks who are doing this really good work to put into place that the resource to create the cultural social change that needs to happen. Because as we were just talking about this the sociopsychological model, that individual is a part of a relationship. That relationship is a part of a community.
That's right.
That
right.
Community is a part of society, and we are all those people. And so if that person that's driving is committing these crimes, doing these inappropriate behaviors, you know, them losing a job is not necessarily creating the culture change that we need or the behavioral change that we need. So from a corporate lens, there are more resources in theory that if are put into place through this larger kind of, you know, social corporate responsibility piece could really create that change. Could not just create the individual change, but that long-term change that we really want.
I think I would really add to that and echo what Chelsea said, because I think, like, if there is a curriculum developed, it should be also a corporate parallel. And,
yes.
Like,
yes.
What are the access, like, for employees who are facing harassment internally? And I think, you know, we all know this, again, like, this is sort of, like, folks who may need to drive on the side for a living. And so, like, there's a class context and, like, more surveillance for particular folks who may be working class or close to that, as opposed to then, like, what are these corporate execs facing in terms of scrutiny? And so it feels very much like if you're going to create curricula or progressive policies and we want safety everywhere, then how is that going to actually happen also at the levels where people sort of have immunity because they're so rich?
That's right.
Well,
so, yes.
And
our
procedure
meeting. I think in addition to what you're saying, though, like, until that restoration can happen, how are you making sure other people are safe? So I wonder if there's some type of information sharing, and not that I believe in, like, sex offender registries or all these different things like that, but if a person violates someone, harasses someone, sexually assaults someone on Uber, does Lyft know?
Right.
Then there'll just be people shuffling. Drive.
Right.
And you can go to the other one, and it may not be something that is criminal where it ends up on your criminal history or your driving history.
So you can just flip on over.
So one of the things that we announced too, so we announced that we're going to do a data, we're going to start sharing this data, you know, as far as assaults. And we're actually going to work with Lyft, it was just announced, to determine how that's calculated, you know, what are the things we're looking at in order to turn this data into a report. And I hope that one of the things that you just hit on, something I think is a big vulnerability, is that a lot of people dual app. I mean, you see it in the cars, they have the logos. And so, you know, is there a way that we could cross share? Because I don't know that it's happening. Sometimes, I mean, obviously when we see some of the cases locally, we will proactively share, especially law enforcement will, because they have contacts with both, but I don't know that it's happening, like, automatically. Mm-hmm.
Well, and that's really, you know, in order for us to get at that kind of social change at that societal piece, like, you know, that change model has to happen across, you know, companies and across platforms. you know, if you know, just speaking from that corporate kind of piece, the, you know, Lyft and Uber who really occupy that space majority, folks will just go from one platform to the other.
Exactly.
If you guys are being restrictive and really
exactly.
kind of
yeah.
really putting into place these really holistic pieces to combat that,
yeah.
once that stuff, you know, starts to come down, people that operate in power and control are going to say, I'm out.
That's
peace
right.
out and go to the opposite place.
Right.
And
it
then that creates
be.
A breeding
yeah.
place.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
It's,
yeah.
it needs to be this energy. So it's a really great point to bring
yes.
up.
So the last two questions we're putting together, and then we will wrap up. So what would restorative justice look like for survivors and for our communities? We've already started listing
mm-hmm.
so much already, but what would restorative justice look like for survivors?
Reparations.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Some free rides.
What does that mean?
I mean, I think some free rides.
Mm-hmm.
If one of their drivers has, like, harmed you or been violent, like, you should get to ride for free.
Mm-hmm.
Especially when we think about like the economic impact towards women of color that have to use pool, that have to do these things because it's cheaper.
Mm-hmm.
That seems like you get a credit.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
What else?
Or some other form of compensation if they don't want to represent the scene.
Yes, like?
Money. I'm not sure.
Well.
Cash.
Yeah. Cash.
Right.
Okay.
I'm trying to think what other.
Wait, I was gonna say
maybe industry that like there's something comparable.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, or public transportation.
Right.
They could give me a car.
Uh-huh.
Drive myself.
I wait, what?
Add mm-hmm. in addition to
oh,
that,
so
they could give me a car.
A car.
They say you gotta ask.
You
gotta, you
yeah,
gotta
yeah,
ask.
Yeah.
Oh,
well.
I'll
write it down.
Car.
Then
it won't need any of y'all services.
And not a hoopty. Not a hoopty either.
Exactly.
Nissan Altima.
Money, but
I was thinking
would also
Lambo.
Say, like, if I experience some trauma, then being able to be compensated or reimbursed for my mental health,
right,
you know,
right.
time off work or something like that. Mm-hmm. But then also say that it's accessible, right?
Mm-hmm.
So that you're not creating, like, you got to do this form or you,
right.
that, you know,
mm-hmm.
so still make it accessible. But if I'm hurt, then, you know, I can apply for, you know, mental health.
Right.
Especially after all the things we talked about this morning. You're
right.
already
mm-hmm.
low wage, you're
yeah.
this, you're that, and then you
mm-hmm.
get assaulted in your only mode of transportation.
Mm-hmm.
What is the, you know, what is the restorative justice around?
Right.
I mean, I also think in terms of thinking about wholeness, like
yes.
not having the trauma be taken forward. So again, like, is what's the process then to understand what happened in that context, like
mm-hmm.
you know, like in the kind of like medical context where like, or in social work context where you have case meetings to figure out like what went wrong where.
Got
and
you,
like
right.
again, so you don't want the violence to go on to some other person, right?
Yes.
So like having a structure and mechanism,
yes,
where obviously the person is supported and compensated. But then again, you know, we all want the violence to end. So how, like, having a specific, like, post-mortem afterwards
yes.
and then intervening and saying, like, with the driver
right.
Or passenger, whoever it might have been,
right.
You know, and kind of having, like, concrete follow-up steps
mm-hmm.
so that it doesn't just end with, like, a payoff.
Right.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I like the idea of post-mortem
mm-hmm.
accompanied by transparency,
yes,
and by people outside the company.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know, people in this universe or whatever. Porby knows this. I have been sort of obsessing is too strong a word,
mm-hmm.
right? But so revelations about Matt Lauer and Tom Brokaw,
mm-hmm.
and NBC investigates itself
mm-hmm.
and decides that it did the right thing, right?
Mm-hmm.
And I don't feel like that was a transparent,
right.
no. useful.
Right.
process, and I feel like they have been enabling,
mm-hmm.
you know, bad actors in this space,
mm-hmm.
and that continues. So if there is not the right amount of transparency, and if
right.
there are not people in the community or who have expertise
mm-hmm.
who can actually legitimate
right.
that work that has been done, then I mean, and it's to me, it's in the corporation's interest,
yes,
right, to be able to do it transparently and say we did this and people agree that ours has been a fair process, so it's a win-win.
Well,
I think
about the accountability piece. Some of the things I was thinking about earlier was that kind of full spectrum of accountability, right? Like everything kind of being on the table with respect to like termination all the way, you know, across the board, right? Being able to have these different mechanisms, you know, whether that be access to like counseling, mental health, like behavior change pieces, you know, through that spectrum, but also holding a space for that outside accountability, right? So maybe that looks like consistent kind of consultation with folks who work in this work, right? And we talk about survivor-centered all the time. Mm-hmm. So what does that look like from an outside lens? Like, is that some kind of survivor caucus that Uber or Lyft could create on a rolling basis that every couple of years that was led so that you continue to have you know, people who opt into this and maybe want to apply, be a part of this conversation. So not only do you have some kind of institutional experts with, you know, policy people, like, you know, folks who are doing this survivor center work, and at the same time holding these survivor voices there, because, you know, we get in our kind of worlds up here and we still need to be connected to the work, and the people need to be connected to the work and they need to have their voices. So maybe there's some kind of like survivor caucus, survivor board that also plays a role into what this accountability forum looks like. Because again, like if we're making the decisions for people, then in many times we're taking those voices away and victimizing folks again because they don't have a voice there. Sure. So I don't know, just because
that's the seat at the table, having a seat at the table.
And it's survivor centered. Like we talk about survivor centered work all the time.
Yeah.
That philosophy should still apply to these these things that we want to create that are gonna be in theory, you know, helping to alleviate and restore experiences. So they have to be led by the people that's happening to and experiencing it.
That's right. That's amazing. Thank you so much. So we've got time for maybe one or two more, and then I want, because it's been a long day for y'all.
I'm not sure how long some